Jain ji, for inviting me and giving me this opportunity today to meet my fellow colleagues, brothers, professional colleagues today. I'm also happy to share that as with Central Council member Manu Agarwal ji, Anuj Goyal ji, regional council members Shri and other Atul Agarwal ji, Mukesh Bansal ji, then other here members present from the branch, Deepika ji, Atul Malhotra ji, Gaurav Bansal ji, and friends here. I always feel pleasure to interact with my fellow colleagues and professional members. I take a lot of pride in my being associated with such a noble profession. And I was earlier involved in associated very closely with Jan Lokpal Andolan also in 2013-14. That time I used to call that auditors are the real Lokpal, and audit profession itself is a watchdog which can create a good citizenship in the corporate citizenship in the country. So friends, I take this opportunity to interact with you. In my political life, in my association with politics, it started in 2000. That time in politics, mainly professional lawyers, etc., were mainly active in politics. But I joined BJP Bharatiya Janata Party. I used to write on various articles on economic papers, etc. And Jana Krishnamurthy ji asked me to join the Bharatiya Janata Party, and I joined. And that time later on, I started this make the chartered accountant cell in Bharatiya Janata Party, very active. I am happy that in last 15 years, the chartered accountants have made a big mark in the political arena, and we have been able to put sufficiently impactful contribution to the economic policies and other government policies. In Bharatiya Janata Party, any of the economic issues or any of the policies where the party has to give any comments or any suggestions, etc., they look towards our group. Particularly, I am very much closely involved into various policy initiatives that the government take, what is the feedback, connecting with the business profession, etc. And slowly, that the image, we have to together build this image that we are not only purely account profession, but we understand businesses, we understand industries, we understand economics. That image itself will create a big boost for our institute and for our own individual growth and participation in the economic field. So friend, these kind of program, these kind of focus, etc., are very important. And I'm happy that Shri Ashish Jain ji and this Agra branch has come out with a very good concept of our goal. The initial, when I heard this word, I was also not very clear what this our goal means. I searched for this in the Google, and I found that it is knowledge, gyan, janana. And in addition, they made a very impactful statement is make a change. Gandhiji said that be the change what you want others to do itself. So start from yourself. And I think this is very important event. And I would definitely like to bring to your some of the important initiative with regard to India's growth in knowledge economy and the contribution or the direction in which Narendra Modi ji's policies on economic reforms, etc., is taking place. Even how Uttar Pradesh is making big stride under Yogi ji, because we all are very closely impacted by the economic ecosystem under which we live. The first foremost I also liked about that we had garlanded and praised Ma Saraswati. My father was very closely associated with Shankaracharya. He was professionally a medical doctor. And that time in his earlier time, he asked once his guru. He was a disciple of Bharati Krishna Shankaracharya. And once he asked, Shankaracharya asked him when he was a student in medical college in Nagpur, do you know that why what the book in the hand of Saraswati signifies? My father said simply, Guruji, it is she is a goddess of learning, and the book signifies knowledge. So what Shankaracharya said, no, it is not that. Simply the book signifies knowledge, and if she is holding it, the book in the hand of Saraswati signifies that the knowledge, the goddess of learning, is still learning. So it is to be a continuous process that we have to pursue, we have to follow, get the knowledge, understand things, etc. That only will improve our own contribution to the society. So this is very important. And the third point that I was just looking into today morning, I was there for, I am in charge of the Kerala election from the party side, one of the coordinator in the Kerala election. And I visited yesterday night only, as chairman said, I came after a very long movement there and participating in their various places. There, I found that the South India, Kerala, is a base of super knowledge. They have a high level of education. The society is very much interested in knowledge economy. There are centers of learning, art, performing art, culture, temple art, etc. And I also visited a Vedic center there. And that shows that how our whole ancient history was seeped into knowledge. And that is the reason, because the India was always in a pursuit of knowledge, that we at one point of time in the history were leaders in globally. And one important couplet you must have heard several times, that Yunan Mish Roma sab mit gaye jahan se, kuch baat hai ki hasti mitti nahi hamari. And what I found, I also read history many point of time. Societies which have progressed across the world, like Greek, Roman, Spartans, etc., they have pursued one particular aspect and put their whole energy into that aspect and created efficiency into that aspect. If the Greeks were known for philosophy and the democratic values, etc., they grew because they pursued with put their full energy into that that area. Romans were known for law. Roman is known for their contribution to the law. Roman society gained a lot of importance because of its single point pursuit of law. Then Spartans were considered, they were also great civilization at one point of time. There, the physical strength was worshipped. Everybody was completely pursuing single-minded pursuit of physical strength. And what India pursued for ages was knowledge. And that is our core strength. If you get into the Vedas, etc., Ved is considered to, what is the Ved basically? It tells, it is the fountainhead of knowledge. And that we all should know. And fountainhead of knowledge doesn't mean that Ved only considers spiritualism, rituals, etc. Ved with four schools and its 10 subordinate schools talks about all the material sciences. It is not only metaphysics or spiritual science, but it talks about astronomy, it talks about metallurgical sciences, it talks about Ayurveda, it talks about archery, and even mathematics. So deep knowledge is there in that. And India pursued that knowledge continuously, and therefore India, in spite of all the Western invasions, etc., is at present standing and is poised to lead the world At present, I have been moving from the party also to various countries around the globe. I participated in China, Chinese G20, the conference, went to Europe, African countries and US also on behalf of party and participated there. Everywhere, people have a tremendous focus in what and India is generating a lot of curiosity across. So this is very important, and today's topic is very relevant. And I congratulate all of you to select this topic, which is in itself can create a big strength for India. Friend, in addition to, I would also like to say that it is not only the knowledge that we pursued, and it was not only because of knowledge that we gained, but because of this, we also were a prominent civilization in the world, because we had a very big growth in the economic side. Not long before, around 300 years back, 27% of the global trade was controlled by India. So it was not only pursuit of knowledge, but even economic control, economic strength, that also India was identified. And therefore, and the important thing is that if you have good economic progress, if you have good strength in the economy, then only you are able to pursue these art forms, knowledge forms, etc. So economy is the basis on which the growth and the economic growth and other things takes place. And therefore, in our government currently, we are all out going for big ticket reforms, economic reforms. Prime Minister Narendra Modi has over 10-15 days back, he clearly announced that good economics is good politics. And wealth creator, whether it is the agriculture, industry and businesses, we are not shy from giving them their due respect, their due places. And I have been talking about, I had several press conferences. At present, I think many of the problems in the country currently have come out because of, I have coined the name crony socialism. People talk about crony capitalism, but actually the bigger problem in many countries is about crony socialism, when you only focus on distribution of wealth without focusing on creation of wealth. So the important thing is the Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji has clearly said that we are pro-businesses, we are pro-industrialists, and we give them equal importance. Our policies with regard to infrastructure development, economic reforms, etc., are focusing, and I am very sure that in near future, as has been mentioned even here, that we target to achieve $5 trillion economy. So we definitely will move in that path. That's very important. And some of the important initiatives that we are at the government are taking, I will also share with them, with you. And I would also request, even this branch or the Institute of Chartered Accountant can contribute into that policy. What I also feel is, at this point of time, the professionals, when I have gone to many places, etc., in one point of time before 2019 election, we had a very big program with Amit Shah. He told me that I want to meet certain professionals. In Bangalore election, it was there, in Karnataka election, and I organized a big program. And before that, I went to some of our institute professional, etc., to ask them to come and talk to Amit Shah ji about various policies. I found some reluctance on their part. And they said, ki, hame kya karna hai? Hum toh business aur isse interest hai, hame politics se kya interest hai, kya karenge? So, mera unko yehi kehna tha, ki agar politics defines everything, or whatever policy is formulated, whatever policies on businesses, economics, or industrial policy we are impacted by that policy, and if we do not participate at the time of policy making, at the time of interacting with the politicians, not actively take part into political thought process, how will we finally then later on when any policy will be implemented, then we start cribbing and then we start telling that this is the problem. And this policy, I have been interacting with bureaucrats and politicians, etc., is that slowly the government tries to move towards the pre-discussion. If any policy is there, it comes out in the public domain, that policy is brought into the public domain. At that point of time, we should actively participate and give our comment. And government definitely, surely tries to incorporate those comments or suggestions, etc. But if you do not participate at that point of time actively into that part of time, then suddenly later on we find that certain laws, etc., have been changed, and that creates a problem that are not conducive to our business community. Though there is surely a problem that in the policy making and into the bureaucratic setup or in the government setup, the thought process of businesses and industries is lacking at point of time, but slowly as a profession, as an institute, as an individual, we can definitely create that ecosystem. That is an important thing. The another point that I would like to present about the policies of the current government is, as I said, that in 1991, India, there were phases of growth in India. After independence, up to from 1947 to 1970, across there was a move towards PSUs, large industrial public enterprises, etc., were brought, and socialism, and it led to 1969 to another, even complete socialism was brought into, and even nationalization of bank, etc., took place. But by 1991, the result from 1970 to 1991, it led to a situation that India went into a very difficult problem. Even on the balance of payment, and our economy was in a very bad shape in 1991. And then in 1991, economic reform process took place. After 1991, if you see the growth trajectory of India's economy, you see a big growth trajectory took place after 1991 when Indian economy was opened up. So that narration is now very clear. And then after, again in 2003-04, our economy went back because of certain policies of more focus on the distribution aspects. So, and the focus on the wealth creation and wealth generation was diverted. The best period of economic growth was when we went into liberalization, economic reforms. The best growth, GDP growth, India saw after independence and post-colonial rule was 1991 to 2002-03. So that was the period where economic growth, reforms, opening up of Indian economy, etc., took place. And taking cue from this, in post this 2019, we as a government are moving ahead for big economic reforms, etc. And that you see in our commitment on the agriculture sector growth. Agriculture sector, in spite of all the efforts and agitation that are going on, we have been committed that agriculture needs big reforms. We need private investment. We need investment from into that sector. We need warehousing, cold storage, and supply chain management. So that is the area that big reforms is our government is going for a big reform into the agriculture sector. Similar is now we have also implemented the labor reforms. The four core that we has been brought, there will be big agitation. I know when in April it will be notified. Certain segments and vested interests will go for strong agitation. But we from the government side are committed to bring labor reforms into the economy, because without industrialization, without growth in the industries, etc., the economy cannot progress, employment cannot generate, and that's very important clear-cut message that the Prime Minister Narendra Modi is giving. And the third important the big focus is on ease of doing business, and ease of doing business comes from growth into the strong infrastructure sector. If you look into the government spending on infrastructure sector, it has moved ahead and it has increased a lot. Even in this COVID, post-COVID time, when the government was finding a strong reservation on the resource constraint, etc., the government went ahead by increasing its capital expenditure. In this budget, we have increased our capital expenditure by 34%, in spite of revenue coming down by almost 26%, direct and indirect taxes. Government has also gone into reduction in taxes, in the indirect taxes. Overall, we know that earlier indirect tax were into the tune of 28% to 30%. Under the GST regime, we ultimately want to bring the whole indirect tax below 20% into the bracket of 18%, around that, except some minor items. Even the corporate tax, we are bringing them down and continue our infrastructure push into road, railways, waterways, airways, bridges, etc., rail freight corridors, etc. So this big infrastructure push that our government is following, in itself, it has two prompt effect on the economy. One, it creates the demand into the economy for cement, steel, iron, etc. And at the same time, it creates liquidity into the whole economy, creating demand, giving demand into the industries, and pushing money into the hands of the people, and at the same time, ease of living and ease of doing business. So these push on infrastructure reforms, pushing committed to agriculture reforms, committed to labor reforms, and committed to industrial development, growth, etc. Our government has shown its commitment to good economy and good economic growth. That's very important. What I would also like to mention here is, we are working in the government on four important policies. And once these policies come, at present, we also request you to, if you have any suggestions, these four important policies that we are currently working and shortly will some of them are draft policies are in the public domain. But once these policies are implemented, we will see a major boost into economic development and industrialization of the country. And that is the focus of Atmanirbhar Bharat. Atmanirbhar Bharat, at point of time, some people think that Atmanirbhar Bharat is going back and coming to the protectionist environment, creating a protectionist environment. We will move away from the global and regional supply chain. But it is not like that. Atmanirbhar Bharat has the focus that we will support industrial development, and on that Atmanirbhar Bharat, five important policies that we are working on, and that will create a big ecosystem for economic growth. That is, India, with such a large country and such a long history, is governed by industrial policy, which was formulated in 1948. If industrial policy, which was formulated in 1948, can be sufficiently efficient enough to create a current industrial development, no. So we are working on a new industrial policy. Though there were 1, 2, 3 amendments in between, but we are working on a new industrial policy. And new industrial policy encompasses whole requirement of industrial development, setting up of industries, ranking of the states on ease of doing business, creating land banks, creating cluster development for sectoral growth in the economy, pharma industries, IT industries, other like those clusters of textile industries, like those clusters are being identified, big move on the transportation, etc. is also being planned. Land banks, states have been asked to identify land banks, put them openly on the government website so that foreign investors, investment from the other countries can come to India. They are finding a big problem on sometimes on the land acquisition and cost of land. That problems also we are trying to tackle. So in another new focus is on new industrial policy, which will encompass many things, which are the need of the industrial business community. Second thing that we are working on is about the logistic policy. At present, the connectivity is a big problem. Road, railways, waterways, airways, ports, etc. And what our study has found in the government that our cost of logistics in India is 40% higher than global cost of transportation. With 40% higher cost into transportation system, transportation of raw material and finished products, our industries are not competitive. And therefore, in 2010, when we went into the bilateral trade agreement and opened our economy to the ASEAN countries, our industry suffered a loss, suffered a lot because they were not competitive enough with regard to cost of transportation. Even the cost like power, land cost, all these are also a complex issue which we want to tackle in the industrial policy. But the second important focus on industries, on economic development is on the logistic policy. And we target to reduce logistic cost of raw material and finished goods transportation cost by 25%. And that is a focused approach that the government want to take under the logistic policy. Everything with regard to infrastructure creation on this multinodal transportation hubs, etc. are being formulated. Even Sagarmala port connectivity, all these things are forming part of that. So second important policy that the government is working is on logistic cost and reduce the logistic transportation cost. And the third important part is in India, at present, there is no retail trade policy. Retail trade is an important area which impacts everybody's life, and lot of our business communities, etc. are dependent on retail trade policy. The government has also drafted a retail trade policy that will incorporate the complexities of the retail businesses, kirana merchant, shop owners, etc. And in addition, along with that is the e-commerce policy. Lot of influx on the digital platforms, etc. coming. Globally, there is a big pressure of opening up of our e-commerce platform. Same time, our domestic industry, retail traders, businesses, communities have certain reservation on e-commerce platforms. So incorporating them, many issues are there. I will not go into those policies. I have been very closely working into that policy. But all the aspects about co-localization of the data centers, taxation issues, management of that, whether those e-commerce platforms will all have a warehousing capacity, should they be allowed to have warehouse, etc., are being taken care of in that policy. And the fifth is import-export policy that we are working, because every 5 years there is a new policy, and in this 2021, new import-export policy will come out. So these five policies I have mentioned where we are currently working, in addition to what I have told are the policies that were implemented earlier, are new industrial policy, new logistic policy, new retail trade policy, new this e-commerce policy, and import-export, five-year blocks, new import-export policy. So I think this is very important area, and you should clearly have this vision that at present the government also knows that there are no low-hanging reform fruits which are available which can be plucked without disturbing the status quo. And the government is completely committed for major economic reforms. Whatever is required, that will be done. What as a profession I would also like to add and request from you is that lot of political capital has to be sent. If I am talking like this, that I am pro-business, I am pro-industrial, we believe and respect wealth creators, then I have to face lot of challenges in the public domain. We are in politics, we are also dependent on votes. The thing is that as a profession, as those who are beneficiaries of the industrial development, economic development, etc., have to create a clear-cut narration. And therefore, I suggest that we should participate into creating good narration in the public that good economics is good politics. Ultimately, a lot of political capital has been spent by Prime Minister Modi ji to the tune that he was accused of being Sood Bhukti Sarkar. What do you mean by, how can you denounce industrialists? How can you denounce manufacturers? How can you ignore them? Can a country progress without manufacturing sector? So that narration as a profession, etc., we need to create at every platform that good economic world over there. The globally, even in the global diplomacy, major decisions globally are taken on economic issues, economic interests of that country. And at present, I find that the narration is not conducive to good economics in the country. This we also have to take care of. And I think this can be one of the major messages from these programs like that. Which is very important. That is at the national level, global level, some of the points I told you about the government policies, etc. What at an individual level, I also would like to touch upon some of the points. We need, for the knowledge economy, you need to get information. That is very important. You cannot just pray in front of Saraswati ji and get knowledge. You have to work hard. Read, get into various information, collect daily basis. Yeah. So as a profession, chartered accountant is a very what as a professional degree, etc., mean it opens your mind to the knowledge, gaining process of knowledge. Knowledge is continuously growing. Knowledge has to be accumulated across the world. Globally, there are new changes taking place. So what we have to do is update ourselves on the daily basis. That's very important. Various at the government level, I have been moving to MSME sectors and other places. People don't know that earlier, it is now last year, etc. I have been before the election, been moving to various places, MSME, other industries, etc. They did not know initiative like GEM, Government E-Market Initiative. Government wants to procure almost 20 lakh crores annually through government e-market. The problem of the platforms, like I was on the board of Bank of Baroda. I have not completed my term on Bank of Baroda. I was on the Bank of Baroda. We came out on the streets that e-market bill discounting platform. People don't know. So profession, as a profession, we have to give knowledge to them, as Manuji and Anuji were telling, that GST is a complicated issue. We have to ourselves upgrade, we have to ourselves impart knowledge that will create good value for our profession. So we have to understand global trends. There are geopolitical strategies which impact. It is not simple when you go into bilateral discussions or trade that you will always get what you want. It's a bargain, give and take. If we have we are looking towards bilateral agreement with US, UK, free trade agreement on there. It is not simply that if what I demand, they will do. They have their own. It's a bargain, give and take, etc. Takes place. So geopolitical strategies, global trends, these are also an important area where we can have to be updated. and certain more initiative where chartered accountants can have a strong role and work in the coming upcoming fields that I just would like to put before you are that 4-5 days back the International Arbitration Center policy government cabinet committee has decided on that India will we will set up an international arbitration center. The government policies on international financial center is very much on the card. GIFT City is one plus other places also we are wanting to look into. Then these things international 60% of our financial transaction arbitration transactions are at present taking place by in London, Singapore or Hong Kong. Why those cannot shift to India? This on this Monday on 15th, I had a meeting with Yogi Adityanath. We suggested that this arbitration initiative of the government to set up an international arbitration center, why it not be set up at Noida? Noida has all the facilities. I live in Noida. Then international financial center can be set up. So we are all living in Uttar Pradesh. Yogi Adityanath is pro businesses. I think he has done wonders in last 4 years. The Uttar Pradesh, which was very poor with regard to infrastructure, law and order, and was considered a backward state with a huge population, in 4 years he has made a tremendous progress. That the country, the state has moved ranking of 14 to second ranking nationally. So that's a big achievement, and he's very pro business. So we all should also look into this opportunity, and he is determined that I will make Uttar Pradesh as one of the leading industrial state, and he has targeted that we will create, along with the $5 trillion economy of Shri Narendra Modi ji's vision, $1 trillion economy for Uttar Pradesh. So we are fortunate that we are living in one of the state which can drive the industrial development growth in the country, and which can drive economic growth for the country. So this is also an important part. Another point that I would like to mention is, as a profession, project financing, capital structure, asset liability matching, debt equity financing, these are very important for the success and failure of the any project. These are only quite well understood by all of us. So how project is financed, how its capital structure is there, that how debt equity combination is taken place, these are the areas which we can create good opportunity for all of us. Certain other issues that in future are also taking shape, which can give big opportunities for all of us. Because India is going for a knowledge economic revolution, whether it is IT, IT enabled services, artificial intelligence, skill development, lot of focus by the government is going on in Atal Tinkering Lab, connecting research development into the industrial, etc. All these initiatives are there and very clearly spelled out in the government website. Issues like environmental accounting. Globally, these are taking a front step in the future, and how businesses will be run, how accounting profession will come, how economy will move. That environmental accounting, green accounting, internalizing the externalities. At present, many of the Agra is facing a lot of problem with pollution, etc. Industries don't internalize the cost of pollution into the accounting process, and therefore many of the costs are not really accounted for with regard to environmental problems. We have to find out ways where these externalities can be incorporated into the balance sheet, human resources accounting. Today only I was reading that the finance minister has given a statement at a global platform that India wants to move towards sustainable and resilience certification for industries. And once these kind of things comes, and implementation of various standards on climate change, etc. These are truly forming part of the new business ecosystem environment. We all need to understand them, read them, and they are not very difficult. Any Google or anywhere, simply if you focus your energy, time, etc., surely you can create a very well knowledge bank for yourself, and in future we will surely can develop into a good professional citizens, corporate citizens, create value for the country, create value for our clients, businesses, and create value for the country. Simply reports, RBI comes out with monthly report of RBI, monthly report on the state of the economy. One report is sufficient in a month to get you the whole ecosystem understanding on what RBI's focus on macroeconomy, microeconomy policies are, how, what initiative they are taking, how they want to develop our debt market, how capital market will be taken care of. These are there. Then Ministry of Finance also comes out monthly with the report on the monthly economic report. These reports we can surely look into, and these were some of the points that I wanted to share with you, so that we are well prepared for the knowledge economy growth revolution that the country is going to see. We are very committed at the party level that economic growth is our forte. We are not shy of respecting pro-business industries, etc. That at all hesitance, which was earlier at points was seen, now is not there. Earlier, we tried in 2013. The first thing I was involved when we tried to amend land laws, land reforms, and we had a big setback at that point of time, and the government under pressure had to withdraw that. But from that time, we have moved towards, we have covered a lot of distance, and even in spite of any hesitation, etc., we are at present committed to the agriculture sector reform. This, it is not over in India, only in India, but across the globe, people are considering. I can give you extensive reports of quote, extensive report of IMF, World Bank, etc., that India will be one of the fastest growing economy in the world in coming and current year. India will be economic superpower, and we are fortunate to have a determined big power leadership in the center and currently the state. The difference I see in Kerala and Uttar Pradesh, for 70 years, 7 decades, there is very poor infrastructure. A lot of knowledge is there in Kerala and other states are there, but the government policies are anti-businesses and that left ideology which denounces business community, etc., have created difficult problems. There is no industry, no. Kerala has well-endowed natural resources, education, knowledge, etc., but the government policies are not conducive to industrial development, infrastructure development, attract business investment, etc. And therefore, at present, Kerala has very low growth into the employment side, and everybody has to depend on remittances. So this, and in other contrasts, in 4 years is Uttar Pradesh. So I think this narration has to be built. This has to go, and we should all prepare ourselves for the coming bright future. Our institute tries a lot of things. And the last point that I would like, some people were mentioning me about that, the institute and ourselves have to have pride in our profession. That's very important. At present, I find no esteem about our profession. We say that we some many times blame the government. The government is responsible. Politicians are just fed by other people, etc. As an institute, as a professional, we should have high regard for our profession, high esteem for our profession, respect our institution, and the same communication channel with the politician has to be open, in addition to the bureaucratic level, directly to the politician, and give them, everybody will not know everything. It is our feedback that is at accumulated and assimilated by the leadership of the country, and we should surely, with confidence, with high esteem, should have regard for our profession and institution. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for sharing and also for telling us the real meaning of the gesture of Saraswati ji holding book, which I'm quite sure most of us sitting here do not know. She's still learning and so do us. As the theme suggests, a both. Also, thank you for telling us about the crony socialism, like government policies, not only for distribution of wealth, but so also for creation of wealth. Thank you for guiding us. Thank you. Now I would like to request all the members of Management Committee and Chairman of Webinar and App Committee, C.A. Rohit Dwarji, Co-Chairman C.A. Vivek Jain and C.A. Amit Sharma, and all other members of Webinar and App Committee to come on the dais for the launch of Webinar and Mobile App of Farmer.
बंद कैसे हो गया? अरे बंद हो गई, ये चल रहा है, देख लो भैया.
I would also request all of the present here to please come up the dais. Give a round of applause, please.
हम तो प्रेम में आ रहे हैं, लेकिन ये लोग नहीं आ रहे.
तो दूर के जाओ ना, वो नहीं आ रहे भाई. आपका हाथ आ रहा है प्रेम में, आ रहे बता दे. या उधर चले जाओ, आगे चले जाओ, फिर पीछे आओ. फोन किसी करो भैया.
अब आपको आपको लीड लेनी है उत्तर प्रदेश.
सर नाउ दिस इज द ऐप विच वी हैव लॉन्च. अच्छा,
अच्छा आगरा का ही बना दिया. पहला तो होना.
हाँ सर, रिकॉर्ड
हो रहा है
सर.
Thank you.